All right, so I'm here to expand upon my partner's affirmatives, but the increasing of the California minimum wage over the next few years will ultimately be a bad thing. So the first significance I want to identify is something that my partner began with a little bit, was that it won't only cause a like loss of jobs, but also a rising of automation. I'd like to expand upon that a little bit more. So from what, this is a Panos Morokotas, said in this article, the $15 minimum wage movement is winning, and that's bad news for cashiers. He states that while the mandates like the minimum wage may help low-paid workers bring home a higher pay in the short term, they send these workers to the unemployment lines in the long term as business enterprises look to replace labor with machines. This is an unfortunate reality that we're living with the gradual replacement of certain industries with mechanization, as I will show you in my next example. Continuing on with the same article, he states that data from the Bureau of the Labor Statistics on employment projections from 2016 to 2026 show that the employment figures for data entry keyers will go down 21.8%, secretaries down 17.4%, assemblers and fabricators down 13.8%, mall clerks and mall machines down 7.5%, and cooks/fast food employees will go down 5.2%. Now, it's hard to take all of that into immediate consideration when you're thinking about not just California's job market, but the federal job market as a whole, but I think those percentages begin to put things into perspective that there is a lot of room for automation to be pushing things in a bad direction for a job market, and raising a minimum wage is just going to encourage that further. So, from procon.org, the minimum wage and pros and cons, one piece of information that they were able to find was that the Washington Post observed that as minimum wage campaigns gain traction around the country, many restaurant chains are already at work looking for ingenious ways to take humans out of the picture, threatening workers in an industry that employs 2.4 million wage staffers, nearly 3 million cooks, and food preparers, and many of the nation's 3.3 million cashiers. And again, granted, that's federal level, that what we're talking about here, but California has a population of about 40 million or so. And so if you take these and you apply this to the specifics of California, you're still looking at about 300,000 for the wage staffers, 400,000 for cooks, 400,000 for cashiers. These are huge numbers of jobs that will be brought down if we increase the minimum wage to 15 an hour, as nice as that sounds. So continuing on with this issue of jobs, with our second significance claim that this will in fact negatively impact most disenfranchised, poorest individuals and businesses, the ProCon website also managed to point out that according to the Statistic Brain Research Institute, 2.38 million U.S. jobs were outsourced in 2015, with 44% of companies saying that they did so to reduce or control costs. That's about an entire million jobs in 1 year that were outsourced because of cost concerns. So this is seriously huge numbers we're talking here. This isn't just a little bit of maybe some jobs going down here or there. This is a serious problem. So continuing on, Osman Batez says on problems with minimum wage increases can push the employee's annual income into a higher tax bracket, imposing a higher marginal tax rate on the individual. So we may think that we're actually increasing people's wages, but since we move them into a higher tax bracket, we would in fact be taking money away from them. This is not at all intended, but this is sort of the problem with increasing minimum wage. You end up creating unintended consequences that hurt the very people trying to help. Back to pros and cons, Matthew Rousseau, a PhD for the Associate Professor of Economics at Susquehanna University, wrote in a 2014 article that the federal minimum wage has a devastating impact on teenagers, because firms will not pay many young workers with little to no skills or experience for minimum wage, let alone a higher wage. So you're going to be looking at increased numbers of people who are young, who can't get into the job market and then can't develop skills and gradually work towards higher wages because they can't get a job in the first place since the bar has been set so high. Back to pros and cons, Casey Mulligan, PhD economics professor at the University of Chicago, stated, again on the teenage issue, the teenage employment index fell sharply after the minimum wage increase of July 2009, the most recent federal one, a fall of about 8% in 3 months, compared to a previous drop of 8% that took about a year. So this suggests that the minimum wage increase did significantly reduce teenage employment. So Moving on to, moving from our second significance claim to our inherency claim that the federal minimum wage is 7.25 an hour and California's is 11. Starting off with a quote by, I think, Ira Stoll, that even low-skill, entry-level positions in many areas are already paying higher than the minimum wage. So, all what we're dealing with is the fact that people can be, in reality, based on where you live, especially in sort of higher, more urban areas, as was pointed out recently, you can be paid higher than the minimum wage already. So, there's certain questions about how necessary that can be in certain instances, but what's also interesting was that it was recently pointed out by my partners over here that in the difference between rural and urban areas is about 60% in terms of how high the living standards can be. The problem with this bill is that it's a state-level bill. It may not be affecting federal level, but you're looking at a state-level bill. I don't think that $15 an hour in Yreka compared to Los Angeles is going to be affecting things the same way, and it might not be the right level to be looking at these things if you even want to look at them at all. So, moving on to our solvency claim that raising the minimum wage will not solve the poverty and inequality in California. Kenton Wells, who from Investopedia.com on the wage post inflation, talks about how as the cost of goods and services rise, as the company is paying higher wages and in the broader market overall, the wage increase is not as helpful to employees since the cost of goods in the market has also risen. If these prices remain increased, then the same employees may require another wage increase to compensate for the cost of living increase. So you're looking at almost a self-fulfilling prophecy of having to raise the minimum wage over and over and over again if we keep thinking this is an answer. Moving on, last two, a nice little trio of quotes from Joseph Minerick on the Raising at the Minimum Wage, which side are you on article. He says, yes, it is likely that the minimum wage workers would spend more of their wages faster than what their employers, but the margin between the two is a sliver of the gross, not even the entire gross. And that there's another possibility, that it's the higher wages would come out of higher prices for the product or service. So then the economic stimulus comes from the difference between the consumption of low-wage workers versus the consumption of low-wage products. The likelihood that this will actually be effective is even smaller. And finally, he says, so in short, the increase in the minimum wage is a poor, poor substitute for real macroeconomic stimulus. Those who yearn for the latter should not seek comfort in the former. Thank you.